scratch
and sniff.
My special guest today is an award-winning actress with many starring roles on stage and screen. She's a member of the groundbreaking Citizens Theatre and the Royal Shakespeare Company. Over the years, she's had several roles risen for her and is particularly well known for two iconic television characters that have lit up the screen. Ladies and gentlemen, from Widows to Walford, a very warm welcome to Anne Mitchell. So Anne, welcome to the programme. My first question to you really is, who were your heroes and heroines growing up when you were young?
You mean as actors?
I guess both, really.
Okay. Nelson Mandela, Che Guevara, Mo Mollem.
Yes, of course.
Yeah. The writers were Steinbeck, Hemingway, Scott Fitzgerald. That generation, my generation.
Were you an avid reader?
Yes, yes, very much so. I love books and I love escaping into them. I love words and language.
And I hear you're a bit of a cinema buff as well, so that was obviously lighting the fuse a little bit at a very early age.
Yes, it did. Oh, unbelievably so. My mother used to take me to the pictures at 3 times a week. That was, we used to call it the Paragon, which is now, which then became the Mile End Empire, now is named something else, the Troxy in Commercial Road, and there used to be a guy on an organ who would come up from the floor.
Oh, fantastic. I love it.
It was wonderful. It was absolutely wonderful. It was all Art Deco, of course. Yes. And the Odeon Mile End Road was also an Art Deco cinema, which is now a block of flats.
Now, how did your parents feel about you wanting to pursue an acting career?
They were very, they were enormously supportive. I think they were frightened, of course, because they came from a generation where, of the Depression and so on. So having a job was of enormous importance, having that kind of security. So when their only child, well, my mother, my beloved stepfather, decided to take such a risky path, they must have been very frightened for me, but they never showed it. They only showed confidence in me.
Wow, they sound wonderful. Wonderful.
They were amazing people.
So what, I mean, do you remember some sort of eureka moment or early pivotal time when you thought, I want to do that, or you were on stage, even if just at home to your folks?
When I was 5 at school, outside the gymnasium, there were some steps going into the gymnasium. And I used to write plays and cast them and direct them. And I always cast myself in the lead.
What a surprise.
And I guess then I knew. I knew from a very early age, Nick. Yeah. Very early, actually. Well, 5-ish.
So in terms of education as an actor, what was your first big step? Drama school or...?
My first big step was to join the Saturday morning classes at the Theatre Royal, Stratford East.
Oh, a wonderful theatre, yeah.
Yeah, that was incredible. I was about 17, I think, and I loved them. But then they closed because the company, Joan Littlewood's company, went to America with some shows. So they were kind of closed for about 2 years, 3 years. And... when they got back, Margaret Berry decided to open a drama school, the East 15, and she rang me. By that time, I had a baby, and I'm the first ever scholarship to the East 15.
Oh, wow, that's fantastic.
I'm very proud of that. Yeah.
I've heard wonderful things about that school, of course.
Amazing training. It was, we were the founders, of course, as Philip Headley, the director, me, and there were about 8 of us in the Robert Walker, who became my second husband. There were about 8 of us in the school at that time, and we really did. It is one of those, if you like, archetypal things where we really did scrub the floors of the school, of the youth club we were in. so that we could have money to go on. And the training was incredible because in the mornings we would train, and it was very much a Stanislavski-based training. And then in the afternoons we would perform at schools. Mm. So it was an amazing experience.
So constant with loads of practical work.
Absolutely.
Every day.
Yes, every day you were putting into practice what you learnt, in the morning, and coming back and analysing it, and the teachers and the tutors would criticise and analyse and so on.
So getting better and better. And Joan Littlewood, did you ever meet her?
Yes, many times. But she had nothing to do with
this. Oh, no, I understand that. I just was curious about what the legend was like.
Well, I liked her very much. I was a bit shy of approaching her, of course. But, she was enormous, had enormous energy and vitality and wit. Mm. She was a very witty woman.
Did you have any issues at all about being from a working class background as well as being a woman, and were you expected to learn RP and all that sort of stuff? Did you have any concerns at all?
No, not that time, because that was the 60s, and the 60s was the time of the working class actor.
So you came in at perfect time.
Yeah, I came in at a perfect time. It was Terry Stamp, Michael Caine, difficult to name the women, of course, Julie Christie and women like that. But it was a perfect time to come in, because to be working class was enormously fashionable and exciting. It was when the world was embracing working class heroes, the Beatles and all of that.
All the kitchen sink dramas as well.
Yes, exactly. Wesker and Osborne. Suddenly a spotlight was thrown on working class experience. Mm. So, no, I didn't have that fear. I was taught RP at drama school.
Yeah. So that would obviously make it flexible for particular roles.
Yes, absolutely. While I was at drama school, I was asked to do a Muriel Spark play. I think it was Girls of a Slender Means. And I did that just as I was ending drama school. That was television.
Wow, very early big gig for you.
Yes, it was. I also did, which was remarkable. That was when I left drama school. I did Talking to a Stranger, which was remarkable. The quartet with Judi Dench and Maurice Denham.
I never saw such a beautiful dress, such a beautiful girl ever in my whole life.
I'm so happy.
Happy, happy. I'm so happy.
I love you.
I love you too.
We'll always be happy. Always and always.
Always and always. World without end.
What was it like in the 60s as an actor? I mean, it was very much a changing time for people then.
Yes, I think what it was... I think it's a very interesting question, that. Because I think my generation and that period in history and the arts was not about forging a career. It didn't seem to be about that. It was a real drive to change things. Mm. We wanted to change things. We wanted to explore different ways of being and different ways of acting and so on. Of course, Brando and James Dean were enormous influences on my generation of actors. Mm. So we were radical in that sense. You know, we weren't following the norm, whereas now I think it's much more conservative,
But you still feel acting is essentially about finding that truth. Do you feel anything has changed in acting styles and all the rest of it that is better or less so than in the 60s?
No, I don't think that...
Sorry, it's a bit of a woolly question there.
I think I know what you mean. No, I don't think it's changed. I don't think there are styles of acting in that sense. I think all good actors are trying to shine a light on what it means to be human, and to look at human behaviour and to look at contradiction. I think what is more difficult now, it seems, that casting doesn't seem to take into account contradiction a lot now. It seems that people want to it seems, want to typecast. I don't think there's the risk. People don't take the risk now of casting someone as opposite, exact opposite of what they are.
So fresh out of drama school, and the parts seem to come your way quite well. I seem to remember seeing you in Upstairs Downstairs playing one of the suffragettes. What was that like?
Oh, it was great. It was great fun. It was a fantastically popular series at the time, and it was a great opportunity to be a fiery trade union leader. I loved that.
There's only one way to save this country, and that's by revolution! Yay!
And also, did you at drama school have much training for TV acting at all? Did you have to learn all that from these early roles?
Yes, we learned. There was no training for TV. During that period, TV wasn't really considered, you know, so there was no training. There is, of course, a great deal of training now in drama schools, quite rightly, because most actors will probably begin in television. Yeah.
I think Louise Jameson said they had one day in front of the camera, or half a day.
No, I don't think we even had that.
Right, okay. Tell us a little bit about the Citizens Theatre Company that you were involved in. And obviously so many wonderful roles came from that. Mother for Courage, Mary Stuart, Private Lives, etc.
Oh, it's... Where can I begin about the wonder of the Citizens Theatre? It was run by three gay guys, Giles Habergal, Robert David MacDonald, and Philip Prowse. And they had a vision. When they came up to the Citizens from Watford. Giles was running Watford, and Philip and David were part of a trio. What happened was that my second husband, Robert Walker, was invited by Giles Habergal to run the Close Theatre, which was the experimental side of the Citizens. And I joined his company, and we did the most amazing, radical, revolutionary things, and were constantly being kind of told to leave Glasgow because there was quite a bit of nakedness. And
was there now, Anne? Yes. Shall we talk about this? You little tease.
It was an amazing, experimental, daring, bold. And Giles and Philip and Robert David MacDonald liked the work that was happening there, liked the ethos of it, and they then began to have a permanent company. So it wasn't any longer, when they started, it was a visiting star. I think Constance Cummings might have been the last one. Right. And then they changed and had a permanent company. And it was incredible because it was so different from anything else. I mean, Philip Prowse was and is an amazing designer with a very particular vision and flair. And Giles was an incredible leader of the theatre in terms of he would always be in the foyer every night with a carnation in his jacket to welcome the audience in. It was brilliant.
How charming.
Yeah, it was enormously charming. And Robert David MacDonald was a dramaturge, a writer, and so on. So it was a feast of ideas and courage. They never, ever compromised, right from the moment. Their attitude was, there were criticisms, how are you bringing, why are you three guys here, one Oxford educated, I think, something like that. What can you bring to the working class of Glasgow? And their response was, we will bring, without condescension, and we will bring the very best of ourselves, our ideas, our vision, and we will not compromise, and we will not patronise, which was incredible. And they didn't, and the seats were 50p, and people came.
Well, was there a lot of improv and, you know, Mike Lee type of workshop?
No, I don't think they were into Mike Lee.
No, I mean, I don't mean him specifically, but when you were fusing ideas together, or was it just you had the scripts and then you would work on it?
Yes, we were given the scripts, okay, which were great classic scripts. Yes. There was nothing for us to twiddle about with them.
Oh, I wasn't sure if you were doing any new plays as well.
I think we did some. Well, of course, Robert David McDonald wrote the Summit Conference for me. Right. So that was a new play, but mostly I did classics there. No, it wasn't an improvisation. No, I think Philip would have dropped dead if the word improvisation had come into the...
Scratch and sniff! Online! With Nick Randall.
So Mother Courage, you were 30 years old, apparently?
Yes, yeah.
So how was that?
Oh, it was a remarkable opportunity. It was an extraordinary design from Philip Prowse, absolutely remarkable. It was like it went through different ages in the costumes and that. And on my waist, I had a real, mark that, a real burnt out ambulance. Philip had made an ambulance, a real ambulance with a red cross on it.
Wow.
That was made in the lightest material they could make. And I had that on a rope round my waist and I dragged that around the stage.
Any photos of it?
There is a very... I don't have it here, but there is a very famous photo of me dragging it that I understand is often exhibited in Europe at various exhibitions of theatre. Strangely enough, I don't have it. I've got to...
If I find it online, I'll pop it on the website for us.
Oh, I'd really love that, actually, Nick.
Everything can be found on the internet.
Yes, I believe so. No, that's great, yeah. But the other funny thing was Philip made us, for the Cenci, which Philip designed at the Close, which Robert Walker directed, Philip wanted us all to have bleached out hair because we had to look slightly diseased, really. So we all had our hair bleached. And I'd never forgotten, the stage manager had the most glorious red, long red hair.
Oh, no.
Yes, he wasn't a vain man at all. It was his one vanity. And he didn't agree with the concept of the production at all, but being totally professional, he had his...
He did it anyway.
Hair. Yeah, he had his beautiful hair bleached white.
I hope he got it back.
He got it back, of course. And I had to have my... I had mine bleached white, and then after that I played Mother Courage, and Philip wanted me to have what he said was the last perm before the war. So for 12 weeks I walked about. Oh, it was horrible, but very effective.
You're listening to Anne Mitchell on SNS Online. Plenty more to come, including her first defining TV role as Dolly Rawlins in Widows, and not forgetting EastEnders matriarch Cora Cross. Time for part one now of the soundtrack of Anne's life. So we always ask our guests to pick a track which either can be, relate to something professional, personal, or just because it makes your feet tap, or all three. And you're allowed up to two.
Okay. Ella Fitzgerald, Every Time We Say Goodbye. Mm-hmm.
And any particular reason for that?
You love it.
I love it, yeah.
She loves it. Let's hear it.
Such an air of spring.
sing about it. There's no love song finer, but how strange the change from major to minor. Every time we say goodbye.
Fitzgerald, every time we say goodbye. You're listening to SNS Online with my special guest, Anne Mitchell.
Different actors I've spoken to haven't necessarily had the range of parts that you've been offered. I mean, did you just feel you came out of drama school so well equipped and also with a strength of character about what you wanted to do? Do you think a lot of that came from the backbone of Anne Mitchell, making sure she got what she wanted?
No, I don't think so. I think you'll find if you talk to most actors, their lives are about lurching.
Yes.
From one thing to the other. What I had internally was a desire to work on great material. I didn't care where it was from. I mean, at the age of 15, I was reading Eugene O'Neill, and before that, I mean, I was 11 when I read Stanislavski and so on. So that was inside me. That was an ambition, but it was also, I knew I could do that. I knew I could do that. That was me, if you understand me.
But I mean, quite often, you know, young women, young actors in the 60s could get a bit sidelined or be, you know, the carry-on girl or that sort of thing. And
yes, that...
Do you know what I mean?
I do know what you mean, because that was... I mean, I look back on that. I did... There was a wonderful series written for me by Troy Kennedy Martin.
He writes all the thrillers, doesn't he?
He did. Yeah. He's dead now. I think you're thinking of his... brother here.
No, I'm old enough to remember when his name came on the credits.
Of course, Zedcars. He's the creator of Zedcars. And John McGrath. And they wrote a series called Diary of a Young Man. And they wrote a role for me in it. There were four leading actors.
They wrote a role for you? I mean, how wonderful is that?
Oh, I've had lots of roles written for me.
Well, I'm not surprised.
It just is amazing when I look at it. I can't explain it. It's just... I'm so grateful and honoured. Yes, it's absolutely. Such an honour. And I've had
I think the honour goes both ways. I mean, they obviously want to write for you because they know what you can offer.
Well, I think with John McGrath and Troy Kennedy Martin, what happened with them was I was their secretary before I went to drama school.
Okay.
And they came to see me at drama school when I played Viola and Sebastian in Twelfth Night. And they came and... them when they were writing and dovetailed. But what happened in that, it was Ken Loach's first direction, of anything.
Yes.
First thing Ken Loach had ever directed. It was great. And I went off afterwards. It was the time when we were all going to Spain. You know, it just begun, Freddie Laker and all that. And I went to Spain, and it had come out while I was in Spain. Mm-hmm. I didn't know. Or, you know, it was different in those days. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that.
And no red carpet.
No. I came back, and I was inundated with requests for cheesecake pictures. I was appalled. Absolutely appalled. I didn't understand what this was about. Now, of course, I would have taken all, I would have had all the pictures. But then I didn't. I kept thinking, I'm a serious actor. What is this? I had a few done that were rather nice, but I didn't understand how you had to play the game.
Yes, yes.
I didn't know that it was a business. I didn't know.
Do you just accept that life is imperfect and there is a game to be played, and why not?
Now I do. I think it's not even a question of imperfect. That's the reality of this industry. I knew nothing of that. I was so completely innocent and just interested in art, you know. But now I would approach it very differently.
It sounds like your innocence really sort of protected you from a lot of potential nasties.
Well, maybe. I hadn't thought of it that way. Mm. It certainly wasn't nasty when they were asking for the cheesecake pictures. They were.
Oh, no, no.
They weren't nasty.
They're tasteful.
They were just... It just wasn't within... I just couldn't get my head around it.
I mean, one of our previous guests posed naked with a Dalek,
exactly.
You know.
I was naked plenty of times on stage, but I'd never had that kind of request for publicity like that.
You're listening to Scratch and Sniff with my special guest today, Anne Mitchell. So we get into the 80s now. Now, obviously, by then, you've had a fantastic range of challenging roles in theatre, lots of different roles in TV. But then you get probably one of the most amazing roles of your TV career as Dolly Rawlins in Widows.
Sliding door in the security van.
Is that what you're going to say?
No, this is a raid. Stick your hands up.
I'm coming, you lot. Don't mess about. I got to go to work.
Look, it's your voice. Can't you lower the pitch?
Don't move! Well?
Face us out, you old woman. Forget it. Look, stick something in your mouth and try it.
Don't! I bleed and choke myself with that.
Did you know Lynda La Plante, the writer, before?
No, this is a very interesting story with this. Before Lynda wrote Widows and before it all came together, about 18 months before that, I had an interview for Chinese Detective.
Oh, David Yip, wasn't it?
Yes, yeah. David Yip. And it was, I don't think it was long after Robert David McDonald had written Summit Conference for me. And for the first time in my life, I went for this interview, I counted the lines of what they were offering me. And there were six. I was very broke at the time. I was working as a receptionist. But I looked at it and I thought, is this all this business can offer me? Is six lines. I went in and I did the reading with the director, Ian Toynton. And he said, that's fantastic. You know, we'd love you to do it. And I said, no, I'm worth more than this. 18 months later, Marilyn Johnson received the scripts of Widows. As I understand it, she said, there is only one person to play this role, and that's Anne Mitchell. And Ian Toynton said, oh, yes, that's the kind of pride we need.
Yes.
But they then went on, as I understand it, to interview 500 actors.
Oh, but they always do that.
Yes, they
go to, then go to the one they decided on originally.
No, that's fair enough. I can understand that. So I must say I love that story. Lynda La Plante didn't know me as an actor, but she approached Max Stafford Clark and asked him, and he said, yes, she's very powerful, very strong, you know, he'd seen, I understand he'd seen work, my work at the Citizens, etc. But quite understandably, she thought I was completely wrong for it. From the picture, all she had was a picture from Spotlight.
Oh, right. I was going to say.
I was 2.5 stone heavier in this picture, and I looked like a kind of aging hippie. I was only 40, but for some reason, it wasn't good. It wasn't a good shot. And I lost, when I knew I had the part 3 months before we started filming. So I went into training. I lost 2 stone, 2.5 stone in weight.
Well, tell me how you do that, Anita. I've just put on 2 stone.
Well, I did it through running. It was really mainly through running at that time, you know. When I went on the first day of filming, there was this gorgeous red-haired lady, but I didn't know who she was or anything. And on a film set, it's very tight. You know when there's someone on it that you don't know. And it turned out to be Lynda. And after she'd seen the first rushes, she sent me a huge bouquet and said, "You are Dolly Rawlins.
I want to talk to you, Dolly. Is Harry still alive? We tried to contact you in London. Harry answered the phone.
I could wear the blue then.
Why did you burn the ledgers?
Look, one thing at a time.
If he spoke to you, then he must be. Cigarette.
Is Harry still alive?
Yes, yes, yes. What else do you want to know, eh? What else do you want to know? What it feels like? What he's done to me? Over and over in my mind. Why? You're all so bleeding clever. You tell me why. He's alive. Living with Jimmy Nunn's bitch.
You've seen him then?
No. I'll go on. Tell me how he could do that to me. Because all I ever did was love him. And when I knew, I couldn't even cry. That girl. A young, stupid girl looking at me like I was dirt. I gave her money. I felt such a fool. Betrayed. Humiliated. Because I felt so ashamed. Because I still wanted him. I still loved him. And even worse, I still do.
Do you think, I mean, obviously, it was so groundbreaking because we had a female writer. We had the legend that was Verity Lambert producing, Lynda A. Graham, who's one of the executive.
Lynda A. Graham, yeah.
Who one of the executive producers? Now, who else was there? Well, and obviously all the widows as well.
Lots of women involved, of course. But I think that was important, very important. But I think as well, it was a first for many people. It was a first for Ian Toynton, directing a whole series. It was a first for Lynda La Plante as the writer. I think it was a first for Lynda Agron. Yeah. And it was a first for me to lead a series, a huge series.
Yeah. And do you think it made a difference that Lynda La Plante not only was a writer, but she was an actor as well? Do you think that makes a difference?
In terms of?
In terms of writing better? Four scripts?
I think so. I think there's a... If you... I mean, you know, Lynda was a prolific actor. And...
Well, I remember as the original Miss Popoff in Rent-A-Ghost, which is probably not her finest role, but...
and a great comedian. I don't think there's any question. If you've worked on so many scripts like that, you know what works and what doesn't. And she has a very, very good ear. Course for dialogue.
Was Dolly Rawlins based on anybody in particular when you created, obviously you were given the role, but when you created your version of her that ultimately was seen?
No, I had nobody in mind. What I was driven by, I felt that the scripts were absolutely brilliant, and they were, the narrative of the thriller was absolutely incredible. I felt what Lynda was also writing about was grief, that this was a study of romantic love and grief. So that's where I put my work, as it were, into that I wanted the internal life of Dolly Rawlins to be about grief and loss and betrayal.
Yes, ultimately betrayal, but also keeping that dignity all the time.
Of course. Yeah. And I also, well, that was terribly important for me because having been brought up in the East End by very strong, dignified women and stylish women, I was very concerned that I would be representing them. I wanted Dolly Rawlins to look not like a cliche of any cliche of the East End.
I mean, I think she was one of the first working class characters that I can think of, female, who seemed so three-dimensional and helped drive a narrative. I mean, she listened to classical music. I think it made people sit up and realise what was patently obvious anyway about the complexity of people. But it was a good lesson learned.
Oh, it was a wonderful opportunity to do that. And the extraordinary thing about the classical record that was played, which was What Is Life to Me, without the Kathleen Ferrier, was the only classical record I had in my childhood. Lynda didn't know that. And Lynda wrote that. She didn't know that it was the only one that Anne Mitchell, had ever had in the house. We had three records, and that was one of them. When I heard that first day when they played it, it actually sent chills through me. Because it was an extraordinary connection, really strange connection.
And I think that piece of music was originally chosen because Lynda La Plante had been interviewing various people to get a sense of the three-dimensional quality of a person's creator's Dolly. And she was surprised by certain things that she just assumed wouldn't be there. Like, I think she spoke to somebody who did have a collection of music.
A criminal mind is often depicted in a one-dimensional way. It's not unusual in American films with Italian gangsters to have a classical background. But it's unusual in British.
We're off then.
Do you have to go?
I mean now.
Yes. We can't leave it any longer. We've got to get there before Rawlins.
We can't risk being seen.
You'll get the police to the club.
Of course I will. Take care. Soon be over.
Obviously, between series of Widows 1 and Widows 2, there was this very sad loss of Eva Mottley. Was there any consideration at all that you just wanted to put the stop on it and not make any more, or was there any discussion about how you would fulfil it for viewers?
No, there was no discussion. No, I was not party to discussions that went on. You've got to remember the loss of Eva, and what happened was in the middle of filming the second series.
Oh, so she'd already been recast?
Well, yes, she had been recast.
I mean, obviously, Debbie Bishop was a very different Bella. I mean, I thought she was fantastic. I thought they were both very good, but it was quite interesting that the casting was really quite different for series two.
Yes, I can only imagine that they very sensibly felt that it wouldn't be possible to recreate the kind of style that Eva had. So I'm assuming they felt it better to go in another direction.
I just thought they might have considered casting somebody more sort of regal looking, like, say, Josette Simon or somebody like that. But at the same time, I thought Debbie Bishop was fantastic. She's also a really good singer as well.
She's a fine singer. Yeah. Very fine. No, I would, as I say, I think imagine, I wasn't party to it, but I imagine the producers, Lynda, felt that they should go away from that, that they couldn't recreate that, so go in a different direction.
someone somewhere left you nothing but a final demand. No one nowhere helps you make it in this no man's land. Hungry women crying, now they're only crying out for more. Hungry winners surviving, now they know what they're surviving for.
Now, I heard a wonderful story, and I'm hoping it's true, but apparently Lynda La Plante, years later, somebody wrote to her and said, isn't Dolly Rawlins coming up for parole quite soon? And how about you write it?
Yeah, I believe that's absolutely true.
It's just wonderful. I love stuff like that.
Yeah, it was true. Mm-hmm. And thank you very much, whoever wrote that.
She's out!
You've got to help me, Dolly.
I just need to know what you told that Inspector Craig.
He grasped me, Dolly. My own husband. You were right.
Can you lay your hands on this?
Please, Mrs. Rawlins, don't do this to me. Don't stay here, Angelique. Go back to your mum.
How much is on the train?
30 to 40 million.
So here's to us. And to the biggest train robbery in history.
Can I just tell you that years ago, when I was a studio manager at the BBC in Bush House, I got in a lift, and you were in the lift with one of your people, and I was so excited because it was the final episode of She's Out, and I'd stayed in the lift and stalked you all the way up to the 8th floor, and I got the courage to turn around to you and say, I've just set the video for your final episode tonight. I'm so excited. I'm really enjoying it. And you were very gracious about it.
Oh, I would have been delighted.
Yeah, that was a long time ago. And then I instantly rushed to tell my mum. I called my mum up. You're listening to Anne Mitchell on SNS Online, recorded incidentally at a home in London with a glass of bubbly on the go. Why not mattress at home, readers? Or just put the kettle on. Anyway, for all things Anne, please seek out her website, annemitchell.net, and her Facebook like page, also Anne Mitchell. So clearly, as such an accomplished actor, the Royal Shakespeare Company calls, and you've worked with them on a whole range of productions, some lasting up to 10 hours on stage. I mean, a bit of a marathon for some of these roles.
The first one was 9 hours. That was
it. Oh, just nine?
No, just nine. That was a snip.
Put a bit of effort into it. Yeah.
That was 9 hours. That was the war plays with Gary Oldman. Yeah.
You do Angels in America as well. Yes. Wasn't that a long one?
That was Angels in America. Wasn't for the RSC.
Okay.
That was for Headlong. That's 8 hours.
Okay.
But for the RSC, I did Tantalus in America and then in the UK. That was 12 hours. That was amazing.
But you do presumably take lunch breaks and wee breaks and things like that.
Yes. A marathon is, you normally starts in the morning. So people have had breakfast, and at about 10 o'clock, then there's a lunch break, and then there's a supper break, normally. And what's lovely about a marathon, or people bring picnics and have blankets and stuff like that, what's lovely about it is that those that have been there from the beginning, and sometimes you can go for 3 plays and then come back another day for 3, but most people want to do the marathon. And the lovely feeling at the end is you feel that the audience feel they've done it with you.
Yeah. Well, absolutely.
We're all in it together.
I think the thing for me is, you see, I get so fidgety at the theatre. I'm on one buttock and I'm on the other. I mean, it's not that I'm not engaged, but I am a fidgety old thing. I would need my own sofa. I'd have to bring my own sofa and pop it somewhere near the shade of a tree, and then I'd be allowed to wriggle around as much as possible. Then I could enjoy that.
Well, I did hear that in America, when we did Tantalus, the 12-hour one, people brought special cushions to sit on. I think they were those blow-up ones. You know, they would be more comfortable.
Brilliant. Are you planning to do any of those again soon?
Oh, no. who knows? Who knows?
Comedy as well. What was Gimme 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 like? Another role written for you, apparently, by Jonathan Harvey.
Yes, it was written for me by Jonathan. Oh, I loved it. Miss Twitch. It's wonderfully fun.
Well, who'd have thought it, Lynda, that after all these years, we'd meet again? That was the hardest screwing ball still, wasn't I, Lynda? There's no need to look so scared. Not now you've been so nice to me and allowed me to live in your back garden. That's my young man. Handsome, isn't he?
Really? We always thought you were a dirty old dyke.
Never confuse being the hardest bitch in B block with being a dirty old dyke, as your kneecaps.
Oh, they're great, thank you. They build up lovely.
It was just great fun from beginning to end.
Yeah.
I absolutely adored it.
I love that show so much. Yes, you can do no wrong, Jonathan Harvey. I love all his Corey episodes as well.
Too. Me too. I think he's a terrific writer.
What was it like working with French and Saunders? And Lynda La Plante, Helen Mirren.
Oh, it was magic. It was only a day. It took a year to get us all together.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, a whole year.
I mean, it was extraordinary. Guest star after guest star coming in and saying...
Yes. I forgot. What did I say?
Because I wanted to get you to say, what a bleeding dump.
Of course.
You're going to do it for us. Go on.
All right. What a bleeding dump.
I love it.
What a bleeding dump. You didn't say that two-faced bitch was in on it. Don't I know you two from somewhere?
Yeah, I thought that.
No.
Dawn Saunders, isn't it?
And Mossy. Where's the old man? He's out now, Dolly. It's Anna.
So what was it like on that day?
Oh, it was a great day. It was great. Very serious, of course. Comedy is very serious.
Oh, yeah.
But what was lovely as well, at the time, Lenny, Henry and Dawn were still married. And Lenny came from another studio and came into our studio. And he said to Dawn, you've waited a long time for this. And it was just lovely. He was very, very supportive. And it was a lovely day. They were so generous with us. But, of course, Helen wasn't there. We acted without Helen.
Right.
She came in later we weren't there because I guess the producers thought we can't wait any longer. This is ridiculous.
Yes.
So when I was acting with Helen, I was acting to nothing.
Scratch and Sniff. Online! With Nick Randall.
You're listening to the frankly wonderful and perfectly divine Anne Mitchell on SNS Online. And if you want to comment on this or any other show, then why not join our Facebook page, SNS Online, or Twitter, which is Scratch and Tweet. Past shows are free and downloadable by searching SoundCloud for SNS Online or Mixcloud by searching for me, Nick Randall.
Now, she's been called the next matriarch of Albert Square, but for a strong woman, well, she's looking pretty vulnerable at the moment.
Now, she's been making a name for herself in Walford as Tanya's fearsome, chain-smoking, no-nonsense mum, but is the formidable Cora Cross about to start showing her vulnerable side?
That is a question. A massive skeleton, though, is about to hurtle its way out of the closet and send shockwaves through the square.
Commandment you ever cared about was the 11th. Thou shalt not get caught, and you couldn't even stick to that. You're what went wrong with my family. Sleeping with your fiancé's father.
Nan, she's my daughter and she needs me.
Let's see what the police have to say, shall we? It's my fault, is it? Rainy and her drugs, your dad's cancer.
I never said that.
I didn't handle that very well. I didn't handle this baby very well. It's all my fault.
I did what you didn't have the guts to do.
And what's that?
Look your own daughter in the eye. The daughter you abandoned.
Now, I thought, as defining roles go, Dolly Rawlins was it, and no other role could trump that. But I also thought it would be a crime if the producers of EastEnders did not at some point create a part for you to play. But you've actually been in it before, haven't you?
Yes, I was in it many years ago. I think it's about 15, or maybe more now, years ago. I played Roy's mistress. It was just a three-month gig, and I was dying with cancer.
Roy faces a difficult choice now on BBC One as Jane's feeling the pain. And discussing her character's plight, actress Anne Mitchell is online right after tonight's EastEnders.
I'm sorry, I'm looking for Mr. Evans. Roy Evans?
He's not here. Can I help you?
Not unless you can do miracles.
Oh, I'm sorry, love. I've only got two drivers on. They're both doing long-distance jobs.
Are you Pat?
Yeah.
I've heard so much about you. I'm Jane Williams.
And I was quite middle class in that role, Jane.
So I'm glad they brought you back, and a role that is very complex. I find it quite difficult to get a handle on Cora because there's so many different aspects to her. At the moment as we're speaking this, she's hanging around bus shelters, nicking cardigans from the local store. You did that yesterday. I watched you, naughty girl.
I didn't see it.
Yeah. You look wonderful, by the way, radiant. But, there's the issue with illegitimate daughter from years ago and then meeting her again and getting sort of fused, if you like, to a family that were already there. What was the whole process like of casting?
I went up for a meeting and I was videoed like everybody else. Mm. And I don't know who else was up for it. Mm. And then they rang my agents and said, we'd like to offer her the part. That was Brian Kirkwood, the producer. And that was it. And I did 3 months first, and then I had to leave because I was doing a play at Hampstead Theatre, Stock Darwa, David Eldridge. And then they said they wanted me back, so then it's 6 months, they do. And then after that, it was a year's contract. And it's always been a year's contract. I think that's how EastEnders do it.
There are a lot of different facets to her. Have you found a really quite interesting part to play?
Yes, I've found it enormously interesting. And what I found challenging and interesting was to bring different facets to the character. And the writers brought. I found that very, very interesting. Mm. And I was grateful for that it wasn't a one-dimensional person.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
One question that I ask pretty well any actor I've had on the show is this issue about rich, rewarding parts for older women, or indeed any parts for older women, and soaps seem to be the way forward. What's your take on all that, and do you think there should be more women writers?
I do. I think there should be more women writers, more women producers, and certainly more women directors and camera people. Yeah. Yes, in every branch of the industry. Now, as far as soaps are concerned, I think the opportunities they give mature actors are remarkable. They are absolutely remarkable. I think in many one-off dramas I've seen where the characters in my age group usually have dementia.
Yeah, yes, absolutely.
They're now it's, anyone over 50 has got dementia, as it were, as far as I can see when I watch television. That's not happening in soaps, unless, of course, it's a particular storyline, which, of course, the management in a soap, certainly at EastEnders, will have tremendous researchers and everybody so that they get it right, you know. No, I feel very strongly about this, Nick. Soaps aren't given credit for what they're giving mature actors. I don't, as Cora, I don't sit in a corner and say, do you want another cup of tea? I don't, you know. I've been in the thick of the action. I've been in a romantic relationship with Timothy West.
Well, when you tell someone you're going to snuff it, that's all they harp on about for ages. I just want to enjoy the time I've got left.
Oh, that's all right then, is it? As long as you have fun. Don't matter about the rest of us.
Let me make it up to you.
Whatever was between us, it's over. And you know how I feel about hospitals. So don't expect a visit.
It's amazing opportunities. Given to my generation of actors in soaps, and it should be acknowledged.
When I interviewed Sandy Walsh, we talked about this issue of not being enough writers, and we thought perhaps there should be... The generation of older people are larger now in society, you know.
Living longer, yes.
Absolutely. Yeah. And perhaps we should, you know, we should have a sitcom set in the care home or something like that, so you'd have a whole load of...
I think it's been done.
It probably has been waiting for God, isn't it?
Yes. I was just going to say... Yeah.
We'll have to figure something else, come on.
Yes, it's been done. Well, of course, what's happening now? She's becoming the kind of soothsayer, the wise one. So they tell me. I didn't watch it last night. But my oldest son, emailed me from Amsterdam and said, she's becoming the soothsayer. Oh,
she's EastEnders shaman.
Yes. You're listening to Scratch and Sniff with Nick Randall.
What a blame dump.
So it's part two of the soundtrack of your life, Anne. Have you had any big things about it?
Yes. Marlene Dietrich, I wish you... Oh, I wish you... What's it called?
She's got a lovely voice.
I wish. I wish you well, or something like that.
I wish you well.
But I wish you some da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But most of all, I wish you love. It's that. And she recorded it for her children. And I would like...
Oh, that's lovely. Like, let's hear that, Anne.
That's for my children. This is for my children, Sean and Che.
I wish you bluebird in the spring to give your heart a song to sing. And then a kiss, but more than this, I wish you love. And in July, a lemonade to cool you in the leafy glade. I wish you health and more than wealth, I wish you love. My loving hearts, and I agree, now's the time to let you be. So with my best, my very best, I set you free. I wish you shelter from the storm, cozy fire to keep you warm. But most of all, when snowflakes fall, I wish you love. Now is the time to let you be. So with my best, my very best,
set you free. I wish you shelter from the storm, a cozy fire to keep you warm, but most of all, when snowflakes fall, I wish you love. I wish you love. I wish you love. I wish you love. I wish you love.
Marlena Dietrich, I Wish You Love, which goes out to Sean and Che.
So you're currently in EastEnders. You've done all this amazing work on stage, on TV, on film. What is there left for Anne Mitchell? What other challenges could there be out there? Or have you ticked them all off the list?
No, I haven't. I've had the most... Now, this is hopefully will happen.
Okay.
Okay. I did the 70th anniversary of the Citizens last month. I went up and with Fidelis Morgan, we did the Fotheringale scene from Mary Stuart.
Yes.
And the next day, the artistic director, Dominic Hills, emailed me and said, what would you like to do at the Citizens? And I said... Long Day's Journey Into Night with Simon Callow.
Simon Callow, fantastic.
Yeah, so hopefully.
But that is a very intense piece.
Yes, it is intense. Yeah, that's the one I read when I was 15.
Yes, so, yeah, I reckon Eugene.
Yeah, I've waited all these years to do that. That would hopefully happen in 2017. Right. We're talking with Dominic, Simon and I, as we speak.
So we'll be in the front row, me and my lovely Andy, waving you on.
Oh, great. I would love that. Yeah, that would be lovely.
Oh, and just before I go, here is your celebrity goodie bag.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes.
Do you
there's
want
some
me
champagne.
To
open? You can open it if you want, yes. Misty. And there's some chockies and all sorts
dream.
Of stuff. It's posh teas.
Oh, fab.
And a posh cup.
Ooh,
to drink it in.
Oh, I just loved it. My goodness.
And the saucer as well.
Beautiful. Oh, thank you.
And on that note, Anne Mitchell, thank you so much for joining Scratch and Sniff tonight.
I've had a lovely time. Thank you, Nick.
And our thanks also go to the BBC, London Weekend Television, Euston Films and Paul Condon. We revert bite-size for our next few editions, featuring a children's author, a hypnotherapist and a stand-up comedian. Now, if that isn't the start of a joke, I don't know what is. But for now, from Anne Mitchell and myself, Nick Randall, goodbye.